It suddenly got quiet. You must think it's time for class to start. Well, let me just start out by saying that I fixed a couple of problems with the microstick description that was on the PDF, and I miniaturized the icon here because I didn't see any reason to have a half-sized image on the page. But if you look at this, there's two changes now. Only, well, aside from the modification notice up here, it turns out that the student who did this, McNichols, who I thank greatly for it, made a mistake when he assigned the pins, because on the data sheet, side by side, are the PIC32 MX1 series and the PIC32 MX2 series. He used the pinout for the one, we're using the two. There's at least two pins that are different, and they were incorrectly written, so I changed them. Pin 15, which on the original document said RB6, does not exist on our package. So you can't use port B pin 6, does not exist. And pin 23, which is RB12, does not exist. It's actually a USB voltage source. So those two port pins are not usable. One of the students in the class was experimenting and chose both of those. I tried both these pins and neither of them worked. Talk about bad luck, you know? That's life. If you find any other mistakes with this, let me know. I'll fix them. Since I just figured out how to edit a PDF. So that's fixed. Right now, these are the office hours. The only office hours that are outside of normal lab hours are Wednesday morning, 10:30 to 12:20, with Sophia. Next week, if people will be interested in using the time, I can open up on Monday or Tuesday morning. Can't open up on Tuesday afternoon or Monday afternoon because 2300 is in there. Also Monday and Tuesday night, they're in there. But I could open up if there is demand on Monday or Tuesday morning. Now I'm guessing for this lab there's not going to be a lot of demand because it's fairly easy. And there was 3 weeks to do it. But does anybody want me to open up? By holding up your hand, you're saying you will be there. So Monday morning or Tuesday morning or both? Monday morning. Wow. Okay. Monday morning it is. Monday morning. So it'll probably be something like 10 to noon? 9 to noon? 9 to 10? What time? Starting at 9 and going till when? Till we can't stand it anymore? 9 to noon? Huh? 10 to noon. 10 to noon it is, Monday morning. Okay. Last thing is, I've seen a couple of students initializing timers and initializing capture units in the while one stanza of a thread. This is a bad idea. What you're doing with the timer 3 or timer 2 initialization and with the compare initialization and maybe the comparator initialization is you're setting up hardware once. Since there's only one piece of hardware, you can only set it up once. You should set it up once. These are not software calls to do a measurement. These are calls to set up hardware. And if you have any doubt about what you're doing, shoot a message off to Piazza or come talk to me or hold up your hand. But you should have a distinctly in your mind, you should know what is hardware and what is software. Anything else? Any other questions on lab one? It's all going okay. Nothing blew up. TFT's blinking when it should blink. Okay. Then let's continue with lab two. At the end of the last lecture, when I was talking about keyboards, as I looked around the room at the end of the lecture, I was not getting a good feeling about the feedback. There were a lot of people that looked like they'd been pole-axed. So I did something wrong. I left out something or I didn't say something. So I'm going to do it again more quickly, but feel free to stop me and ask questions. The keyboard we're using, again, is a switch matrix. And we are going to read this by reading B7, B8, and B9. Pins B7, B8, and B9. And the stimulus for reading this are going to be a pulse applied to one of the rows, either from pin A.0, A.1, A.2, or A.3. We can read these three bits all at once, and if we read the three bits, they are going to show up in bits 7, 8, and 9 of the port B register. So the value of this bit is 0x4, 2, 0x200, bit 9, bit 8 is 0x100, and bit 7 is 0x80. We better only read one of those numbers at a time. There should never be a case where two bits are set, because that means the silly human is pushing two buttons at once. We're going to decode rows by putting a pulse on A0, reading the result, then putting a pulse on A1, then a pulse on A2, and a pulse on A3. So we're going to read rows sequentially. We're going to look for a non-zero value on B7 through B9. If we find a non-zero value, it means a button was pressed. Once we know that a button is pressed, then we can figure out which button from knowing which pulse we just produced and the bit pattern at the three bits of output. There's a couple of details. You need current limiting capacitors here. I suggest 300 to 330 ohm. Here you either need to turn on the pull-down resistors, the internal pull-down resistors, or you have to attach a pull-down resistor to each one of these. Because in no case can you allow an input to float. And you want these pull-downs to be on the order of 10K or so. So this, so we got sort of here. Is this all clear at this point? Is it clear what we're doing? Yes.
What are the hex values on the
So bit 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that's the first hexadecimal digit. That's the second one. Third one is here. So bit 7 is that one. Right. Counting from 0. What else? Anything else? So let's look at some code that implements the scanner. And we go to the TFT display and keyboard scanner page, and there's a bunch of stuff on the keypad, but in particular here are the macros for defining the pull-ups and the pull-downs. So I tried to make these look something like plib, except I didn't start them with M for macro. And they do two things. One is I'm hypothesizing that it's a bad idea to turn on the pull-up and the pull-down for a port at the same time. So my macros, if you ask to turn on the pull-down, are first going to clear the pull-ups and then turn on the pull-downs. And if you enable the pull-ups, it's going to enable the pull-downs and set the pull-ups. Yes? You do not attach anything externally then, except
right,
the keypad.
That would already take care of like whatever internal thing.
So what you have to make sure is that an input pin never floats. So if this is the input pin, we can model this system as something like this. There's a pull-up resistor with a switch to VDD. There's a pull-down resistor with a switch to ground. There's a high impedance Schmidt trigger buffer, which then goes off to a register which is connected to the bus. Likewise, this register goes through a tri-state back to this pin. So when you set the output, so set the pin to an output, it turns on the tri-state. When you set it to an input, you turn off the tri-state. But in any case, you have a buffer at the input and selectable pull-up and pull-down resistors. I don't know what these values are. You could look at the data sheet. They're probably between 10 and 50K someplace. So yes, if you turn this resistor on, it completely replaces the external resistor. And because of the way these registers are organized, you can OR together bit numbers and turn on 3 pull downs at the same time. How very handy. So now let's look at the keypad test code. And I was really lazy here. I just took the TFT test code and I added one thread. So you'll recognize the timer thread, the color thread, the animation thread, but then we have the keypad thread, which is the interesting part. And the first few lines tell how to wire this, assuming that you're going to use the A port and the B port, as I talked about on the board over there. Oh, I should say also, let's go back up to the top level here for just a second. and look at this rather messy table. We have 16 keypads, which you might use for a final project. We have 12 keypads. I bought the 16 keypads at three different times, and so there are three different connection patterns. But the 12 key, which I strongly suggest that you use for this lab, has one connection, and that is that pin 1 on the top edge of the keyboard goes to column 1, and pin 2 goes to, I'm sorry, row 1, pin 2 goes to row 2, and so on, and then the columns are on pins 5 through 7. So that's how you're going to wire it. Going back to the test code now. What we're going to do here is to first build this key table I mentioned that will convert a scan code. So if we press this button right here and connect these two wires, when A0 is high, then the A port output is 1 0x 0 1, and that is going to drive B7 high, so that if we OR together these three bits and these four bits, we're going to get 0x 8 1, right? So 0x81 is the scan code for button 1, and so we'd like a table that converts this to Unity. So what we're going to do is we're going to build a table. I can't point to the screen. I have to build a table, 12 entries for 12 keys, whose first entry is the scan code for 0. The second entry is the scan code for 1. Aha! 81. The third entry is the scan code for 2, so that the index of the table becomes the label of the button you pushed. Okay, the index of the table becomes the label of the button you pushed, with the exception, of course, that buttons 10 and 11 are special buttons. They're going to be star and hash. Any questions on that? So then we're going to set up the digital outputs, and we're going to set up pins A, port A is bit 1, 0 through bit 3 is outputs, and port B 7 through 9 is inputs. And then forever we're just going to check bits. And what we're going to do is to clear all the bits. Clear the bits, do a port A clear bits for these four bits. We're going to set the scan pattern to 1. That represents the fact that I'm going to scan line A0 first. So I'm setting the pattern to 1, which is going to be the A pattern. We're setting now port bits to the pattern. So I've just set these four bits to 1. We yield for 30 milliseconds because we want this system to execute about every 30 milliseconds. Again, I'm choosing a time which is kind of like the geometric mean of the response time of your index finger and the button bounce time of the button. You have a response time of around 200 milliseconds for your finger. The button bounces about every up to maybe 5 milliseconds. You get mechanical bouncing. So you pick something about ratio wise in the middle of those two. That's around 30 milliseconds. So for each of four rows now, for each of four rows of the keyboard, we're going to read these three bits. So we're going to read bits 7, 8, and 9. And then we're going to ask, was it 0? If it was 0, then nothing, no key was pressed on that line. If it was non-zero, then we're going to OR together the button, the bit pattern that was read with the pattern that stimulated that read, in other words, the A port, and then we're going to drop out of that loop with a break. Because after we read the first valid, we assume that's the only valid. Otherwise, we're going to clear the bits. We're going to shift the pattern one to the left. In other words, we're going to make the one into a two and output it on A port A1. And then we set the ports A again and repeat. Once we've done that for all four rows, we either know which button was pushed, or we know that no buttons were pushed, or that there's an invalid code. So now we have to search the table to see if we have an invalid code. Because if you have two buttons pushed, you'll have an invalid code. It won't be one of the 12 that's in the table. So we just see if we got a match between this key table and the keypad pattern. And when we get a match, we drop out of this loop. On the other hand, if keypad is 0, it means person hasn't touched the keyboard, or there's an invalid, and we set the value of I to minus 1, which means no press. Then all we have to do is to draw that on the TFT, and so we're going to write out I, the index of the table, which is now the button number, except that if I is 10, we have to make it we have to make the character equal to star, and if it's 11, we have to make it equal to hash, and then we write it onto the TFT. So the first thing you do when you hook up this keypad is you're going to run this test code, and that'll test all of your connections at the same time for the TFT and for the keypad. Because you should be able to press each of the buttons and see the correct character. So let's say you don't see the correct character. What do you do next? How are you going to debug this? Well, that's a good idea. Check the hardware and make sure there isn't a blown wire or the CPU isn't hot. Yes. And then what? Well, there's a couple of logical steps here before you get to the character. You could print out the scan code and see if that's correct. So if you printed it out using a %X format, it'll print it in hexadecimal for you so that you can then compare it directly to the table entries and see if it's correct. Compare it directly to the table entries here. Once you have this connected correctly and you've debugged it all, then you're going to take this whole scanner and you're going to make it into a function call, because the next level state machine above this is going to have to call this a bazillion times. So the debounce state machine is going to call the keyboard scanner over and over again. We haven't talked about the debounce state machine yet, but we will very soon. And that is going to ask over and over again, is something pressed? Is something pressed? Is something pressed? Has it changed? Has it changed? About 30 times a second. So this has to be changed into a callable function instead, or it could be left as a thread, which you would spawn. You could leave it as its own thread and spawn the thread. Your choice. So you can call it as a function within a thread, or you can spawn a process. Okay.
So I'm able to get like all the key presses at the same time.
So you're scanning one of these at a time?
Yes.
And leaving the other ones as inputs?
Yeah. Basically I'm just getting like a 12-bit input. So that tells me like all the combinations of it.
What drives this system?
Like a thread.
Wait, I mean if this is set to high and these are all set to float, then
I'm reading B7 to B9. I'm only switching A0 to output. All the others are input.
And then you have to then switch A1 to an output later.
And then close A1.
Sure, okay, you can do that. It doesn't detect this push button combination though.
It does, because I'm doing a for loop. Basically I'm just scanning through these 12 dots.
So what's the advantage?
So I can get like
I see, so you could do chords this way.
Yeah.
Very good, that's very true. So let's say you wanted a shift key. Then this would give you a shift key, you're quite right. So let's say you wanted to turn the star key into a shift key, so now you have, instead of 12 buttons, you have 22 buttons. That would work, yeah. Whereas my method would not.
Also because we have to like press the star and press other buttons.
No, you don't. Where does it say that? So let me see here. Or any other button you want. Doesn't it say that there? Where does it say that?
Down.
Or any other button you place on the whiteboard or any other scheme you want. Otherwise, yes, you'd have to do it that way. I tried to make it easier by giving you the choice. So we have a whole bag of 10-cent switches in one of the drawers that you could put on the whiteboard and sense with any port you'd like using either a pull-up, an internal pull-up or pull-down resistor.
You might have mentioned this before, but if we decide to put the keypad in a function, we can't use PT yield, right? So how do we delay without stalling?
So if you put this in a function, you cannot use PT yield, but PT yield would be at the next level thread because something is going to happen, because the state machine, the debound state machine, is going to run at 30 per second.
Okay.
So let's talk about state machines. Any other questions before I erase this? So the button is so fast and you're so slow that there has to be a matching logic that deals with this. And we're going to do all the debouncing in software. You can do it in hardware also, but we're not going to do that. And the formalism I'm going to use is that a state is going to be represented as a circle, and there's going to be a name here and then a test here, and then I'm going to use all binary tests, so the outgoing arrows are going to be notated either yes or no, as the result of the test, and then each one of these can have an action associated with it. The classic way to do this is a four-state state machine. So we're going to have at reset time, we're going to drop into a state called release, because we're going to assume that the silly human is not holding a button down when they reset the system. And what we're going to do is ask, is the key code equal to minus one? If the key code is equal to minus one, it means nothing's been pressed. So if the answer is yes, all we're going to do is call the keypad function again. And remember, this is happening every 30 milliseconds. So 30 milliseconds later, it calls keypad again and reads the state again. If the answer is no, then a button was pushed, and we're going to, at this point, do two things. First, we're going to have a variable called possible, which means that this is possibly a valid press, which has the value of key code. And then we're going to call keypad again. Here, we're going to call this the state maybe, for maybe pressed, maybe. And we're going to ask, is key code equal to, and what we want to show here is that nothing has changed, that whatever the user was doing, they're still doing the same thing. They're pushing down the same button, or they're pushing no button. If they're pushing down the same button, we can check to see if the key code is equal to possible. If it is, that means that everything is stable, nothing has changed, and we have a valid key press. If the answer is no, we go back to this state and call keypad. Once we have a valid key press, then on the transition, not in the state, but on the transition between states, then we're going in this lab to do a couple of things. One is we're going to record a digit. And we are going to play a voice. And then we're going to fall into the next state, which we're going to call still pushed. And we're going to ask, is key code equal to possible? If the answer is yes, then the oh-so-slow user has not released the key yet. and we call keypad. If the user has, if key code does not equal possible, no, then all we do is call keypad, and we fall into a state called maybe released. Here, if the button is bouncing and key code is equal to possible, and that can happen because if on the release you happen to hit this state just as the user releases, then you will get an invalid match here. You'll drop through this state and then the button bounces closed again and it looks like it's been pressed again, so you have to drop back to here and try again. So if the answer is yes, we have to go back to keypad and wait some more. If the answer is no, then we just call keypad and set the state to release.
Is keypad also called between maybe and so push?
Thank you. So this says that if I summarize this, on two sequential reads of the keypad, the pattern of pushing on the keypad must not change. And on two successive releases, it must be zero both times, or it must not match both times. So there's an interlock for push and there's an interlock for release. And somebody in the class is going to say, I don't like this system, I want to do it my way. And you can do that. But if the TAs can break it. So this system is good against extremely fast and extremely slow button pushes. Let's say you just lean on the button and hold it for a minute. It better not repeat. So if you come up with a different scheme, it should have an interlock for push and an interlock for release that determines validity. Does anybody have a scheme they prefer to use? Nobody? Really? Wow. There's always somebody that wants to use a counter. No? Yes?
Can you just like
walk? Say again?
Can you just like if I press down the key and releases, that key cannot press that key again in like a second?
Oh, that's terrible though. That means if you have fast finger that you can't type fast. So the advantage of this system is that you can push as fast as you can physically push because you're above the bandwidth of your finger. But you still are detecting button bounces because that's yet faster, and you're filtering that out with this. You can also do this with set reset flip-flops and capacitors, but we're doing it in software. questions on this now? Well, let me show you some pseudocode, but I didn't want to give it all away. So I just wrote the pseudocode for one button. Where did I put that? Maybe it's in lab two. State machine pseudocode, yes. So there's going to be a keypad thread that scans the keyboard, possibly with by spawning a thread or by calling a function, runs the debounce state machine, places valid key presses into a digit buffer, handles array start commands, waits for 30 milliseconds, and does all the DDS stuff. But it's basically going to look like this. You're going to have some thread that waits for about 30 milliseconds. You could tune that. If you're fast, you might want to tune it to 20. If you've got a button that bounces miserably, you might want to make it 50. And then press here is going to be some port pin true when pushed. So this is only decoding one pin, as opposed to this state machine, which is decoding what is only decoding one button, as opposed to this, which is decoding all of the buttons simultaneously. It's debouncing all the buttons simultaneously. We're going to check for some port pin true and then switch on push state. Case no push. If press, push state equals maybe push, else push state equals no push. And I think you can see the pattern. Every state machine is going to devolve into a case statement. And an element of the case statement is executed at a rate determined by the state machine you desire, in this case 30 milliseconds. The only one that has anything besides a state transition in it, a test and a state transition, is maybe push. If it's still pressed after the second check, then you do stuff to, you put in code to do stuff. Record a digit, make a tone. Otherwise, you go back to no push and wait some more. It's a very regular structure. It's a case statement with a binary test. It's extremely straightforward to code. But there'll be somebody that doesn't like it. I'll be interested in seeing what people come up with. We go pushed. If it's pushed and it's still pressed, leave the state at pushed. Otherwise, set the push state to maybe no push. Break. Oh, and remember, cases fall through unless you say break. So every case stanza has to end with a break. Otherwise, the next case statement will be executed. C is unusual in that regard. So all you're going to do is build a little four case statement that's going to be the debounce state machine. And you may want to inline, before you do the switch here, you may want to just inline the key function, for instance. Or you may want to put it, you may spawn a process that waits for and wait for it to return. However you want to organize, that's fine. Questions? Well, let me just give you a teaser for the next topic so we can warm up the neurons for that. And then I'll get more questions probably next time when people are actually starting to code this. We have to do direct digital synthesis, which is a process to synthesize a precision frequency sine wave from a table. You can't afford to do sines and cosines in an interrupt service routine. It's floating point. It's way slow. So what we're going to do is we're going to traverse a sine table. And the clever thing here is how DDS decides to increment through the table. You're going to have a table of 256 sign entries represented as some index 0 through 255 and appropriately scaled. We'll talk about that later. And we want to know which one of these samples to choose. So we're going to step through it in a way that makes the steps equispaced, and we want the control variable to be linear with frequency. So what we're going to do is we're going to note an interesting fact, and that is that there is a topological similarity between register overflow and wrapping through 360 degrees. In particular, so you start at zero, you have a phaser. Remember phasers? From what, 2100? They're back. So we have a phaser that's rotating here, 0 to 360, and then it starts over at zero again, zero phase. That is topologically equivalent to a 32-bit register overflowing back to zero after one, after it fills up to 2 billion whatever it is, or 4 billion whatever it is. So we can represent every overflow of the 32-bit register as signaling the start of a new sign cycle. Okay? And we're going to choose the top 8 bits as the index into the table. Because as we go from 0 to 256 in the top byte, we will have traversed all 256 samples of the table, and we'll be back to the beginning again, where we want to drop back to zero in the table. So, what the hell are these bits for? Why are these here? You can think of them as representing fractional samples in the table. You can think of the binary point as being here, with one sample being that bit, and this being a half sample step. What do I mean by a half sample step? Oh dear. What does that mean? That means I'm going to play the same sample for two time steps in a row. But that gives me half the frequency. So having all of these bits out here means that you can set extremely fine frequency control. In fact, more than you need for this lab. More than is humanly discernible, in fact. You can set extremely fine frequency control by setting how fast you increment the phaser. The faster we increment this register, the faster we increment the register, the faster the phaser is rotating, and therefore the higher the frequency, and it's linear. I mean, I'm going to tell you how it's linear. I'm going to give you the function that describes this next time. But the central abstraction here is that one register overflow is one sign cycle output. And I'm beating on this because experience shows that there's something obscure about this. I'm not quite sure what, and this is an occupational hazard with teaching this like 20 times in a row. Everything's easy. Well, yeah, I've seen it 20 times. So there's something obscure about this that confuses people, and I'm not sure what it is. Otherwise, I'd try and fix that. But we're going to traverse a table. We're going to use the top 8 bits. It's going to overflow from the top 8 bits, and as it overflows, we're going to start the next cycle. And that's all there is to it. It's two lines of code. You can generate a sine wave in two lines of code. an increment and a table lookup. It's embarrassingly easy, folks. And yet there's something about it that is perplexing. Maybe it's because it's embarrassingly easy. I'm not sure. What do you think? How does it seem? Does it seem like what the hell is he saying? Or does it make sense? I mean, ask questions next time. I mean, we're going to go through code until you can't stand it anymore. But the idea is do a table lookup, either step very slowly, so it at very low frequencies, you're going to output the same sample over and over again, and at very high frequencies, you're going to skip samples. You don't have to play every sample in the table, but you're going to skip them in such a way as to be equispaced in time. So you may not play every, there's only going to be one frequency at which you play exactly all of the samples once per cycle. I think this bothers people too. You build a table and then you don't use it? You don't use all of it? Oh dear. Okay. See some of you in lab. Come with questions next week. You might look at the DDS reference in lab too and come with questions about direct digital synthesis or keypad or whatever.